is the setup of the problem I want to discuss today, and hopefully I can convince you with that's not too unrealistic and maybe has some interest. So we're going to look at the easiest possible perceptron, which is the linear perceptron, which is represented by this circle, which is trying to learn random associations between correlated inputs, which I'm representing here as signals that evolve in time, and correlated output. Okay, so just to set up, the correlated inputs are represented by this matrix Xi mu, and the mu is, you can think of it as an index of time or patterns, and inputs have a certain mean, which can depend on the so-called, like, we can think of this as presynaptic neurons, and sigma i's are the standard deviation. And then we will set the correlation structure of these psi I mu, which are the mean removed input, and the same for correlated output. Okay, so the output will have its own mean and its own standard deviation, and then we will decide whatever correlation structure we want. So all of this boils down to basically solving a regression problem. And I wrote the loss function here, which in general depends on the input x, on the output y, and on possible regularization gamma, which is an L2 regularization. So what you have to do is basically you sum over all the patterns, and you can think of this as summing over time, and then take the scalar product between the synapses w and x. You add some sort of bias. You can think of this as a constant current, can be an excitatory current, can be an inhibitory current, and then you want your process input to be very, very close to the prescribed output. Okay, so what we want is that we want these inputs to come from excitatory fibers. That means that these weights are constrained to be positive, and the blue ones are constrained to come from negative fibers. So they get multiplied by negative synapses. And so that we think of Wi to be greater than zero for when I is less than FEN. So FE represents the ratio of excitatory to inhibitory fibers, excitatory to inhibitory presynaptic neurons, and the other ones are negative. Okay, so now it's my job to sort of convince you this is somewhat interesting problem. And the starting point will be training a recurrent neural network. Okay, so we start from what I consider like the hydrogen atom of theoretical neuroscience, which is the so-called SCS model, the Sompolinsky-Crisanti-Sommers model. You can think of this as like a continuous time version of a spin glass. You take a random network, you just draw Gaussian recurrent weights, this Jij, and you scale the variance accordingly. And the dynamics of this network will basically like chaotically wander around this very huge state space. And this has been studied to death. We know many of these using dynamical midfield theory. And then what we can do from this sort of reservoir, which you will use for computation, is that we can try to read out something from this random neural network. Okay? So we set up some readout weights, say, which are indexed by k. These are weights w. I'm just representing one. And if we let this thing evolve over time, we will see that some sort of spontaneous activity, which is when projected onto this random w network, will look something like this. Okay, let's say we want to transform this random network to what is called a functional network. We want this network to do something, maybe to respond to some stimuli in some way. The very popular force learning algorithm, what it does is that it just learns the readout weights, so these weights W, and then has some feedback from the readout to the actual neurons. You can think of this as a rank K, when K is the number of readouts, perturbation to the initial completely random connectivity matrix. And if you use a very fast least square method, like a recursive least square, you can train these weights. And after training, so after learning, you will have the post-learning, the network is able to, for instance, self-generate some very complicated readout. So what about the recurrent weights? Of course, there are many ways. There are all the stuff that we know from gradient-based learning. And gradient-based learning in this case would be a way to solve the credit assignment problem. So we given an output z of k, which has to be equal to f of k, which we decide is the prescribed output. We have to assign a certain time course to each neuron over time, right? So one way to circumvent completely this this problem, which is naturally solved by gradient descent, is to restart completely and invent a second network, which we will call the teacher network. This is a non-trained, completely random network, which receives as an input the output that we want. So we want to generate an output here to read it out. And so we feed these output to a completely unstructured, say, a non-learned network. And then we take the target currents, which is with the, which this teacher network generates, and then we match these currents, which we read out from the teacher, with those of the student. So what the student has to do is that each neuron in the student has to reproduce the time course of the current. So these currents are representing here at HIS is the current generated by or impinging on the neuron I in the student network. And it's basically like the row of the J matrix time phi, and this phi can be whatever. So in a rate network can be like what we call the rate activation. In a spiking network can be the postsynaptic potential that when we integrate the spikes of presynaptic units. And it has to be equal to the target currents, the HIT, which are generated by this teacher network, which gives, which has an input with these random weights U, KI, the actual output FK that we want. So by introducing, by circumventing in a way this this problem of credit assignment, we factorize the problem at least along neurons, right? Each neuron has its own targets, and in parallel, it has to learn some time course. And so, of course, we can rephrase this as a regression problem. So we have a loss function. This loss function, in principle, is just a sum overall of loss function over every neuron. And we have an output, which is the current in the teacher, and HI is the current in the student that we want to learn. We want to learn the JJs and possibly bias in order to match these two, okay, with some form of regularization. I don't want to give you the idea that this only applies when you take the teacher, you use it to generate the targets, and then you throw it away to use the student. So this can be used in general and has been used by Christopher Kim, for instance, has been used very recently by the group of Kanaka Rajan, when you actually have some recordings from neurons in the circuit. So you have some recording at the level of single neurons, or you can have some recording at the level of population. And so you have those targets, which are not just generated by a random network, but of actual recordings. And you want to construct a student, say, which reproduces those activity. And you can do different things. You can, maybe you have some measurement on the current themselves. Maybe you just measure the activity, and then you want sort of to infer the current. That's what Kanaka Rajan, for instance, is doing, to sort of infer the differential effect of different areas in her network approach. Okay, so what happens if we remember something about the brain, which is the brain respect Bayes' law, which is the fact that the courses differentiation and the courses division in the brain is that between neurons is that we have excitatory neurons and inhibitory neurons. We have to consider a student which is divided into two populations, so an excitatory population and an inhibitory population. Of course, we can play the same game. We have a teacher which is itself divided into an excitatory and inhibitory population, and it receives as an input the same readout that we want to actually read out from the student. Okay, this opens all our breakthroughs in this case, because you have to solve many other problems. It's not easy to generalize recursively squared to this constraint, to when you actually have constraint of synapses. chaos suppression in AI networks when they are in the balance, so-called balance regime, is complicated. And actually, we studied this a lot, especially Reiner and Gemken and Sven Gedeke are gave sort of a complete dynamical mean field theory description of this problem. And so, okay, let's jump right to the spoiler. It's actually possible to solve this problem. You can construct these models which have this this layer of biological plausibility, in the sense they are composed of two different populations. So, for instance, and here I'm showing some results like a network of, I guess, 400 units, 200 excitatory, 200 inhibitory neurons that just oscillates over time, produces this self-sustained nonlinear oscillation. In this case, you know, sort of a functional network which receives two different signals with a delay period delta tau, and then responds with a bump which is exactly at the same with the same delay period. Okay, so this is the actual response of the network, and this is the input. Okay, so we can do that. But then at some point we sort of ask ourselves, the regime, the dynamical regime in which a rate network or a spike network would operate, strongly depends on the kind of solution that we have for this regression problem. So we're asking each neuron to independently solve a linear perceptron problem with constraints. So we have a resulting connectivity matrix, and the structure of the connectivity matrix acts feedbacks on the actual dynamics of the network. So the internal dynamics of the network will depend strongly on the structure of the learned connectivity. Okay. And so, and now I hope that I motivated the fact that we can consider a linear perceptron task with excitatory and inhibitory constraint as sort of a toy model of target-based learning. Okay, we can consider like these targets coming from a random network. We can consider these targets to be actual recording, for instance. Okay, so let's put some more ingredients just to formalize mathematically the problem. We said that we have some correlated input, correlated output. We take the number, like the time length, if you wanted, the number of patterns to scale with the proportionality factor alpha with n, which is the number of synapses. The output is correlated with this metric CY. And for the input, we consider two different correlations. One, the first one, which I call the ensemble covariance. I don't know why I gave this name, but ideally it means that you have uncorrelated, we have no correlation among neurons. Okay, so that you have Xi and U, Xi J and U, there's a delta IJ, but you have only correlation which have been called semantic correlation, or correlation in time, if you want. And the second one is the sample covariance. We assume that we measure something. We measure the targets, for instance, and we do PCA. So in order to do PCA, we just take out the mean, we normalize, and we have the Xi can be written with an SVD as U as V transpose. And let's assume that we know S. So we know the spectrum, if you want S squared, we know the variances of PCA. And we don't know anything about actually the direction of PCA. So we will average over U, we'll average over V. This is the model. Okay, just two words for the method. The method that I used was just the usual replica method. Maybe we can talk about this afterwards. But basically what you have to do is you write the free energy, and then the free energy is sort of a generic function for all the important quantities that you want to measure, say once you average over the distribution of the input and the output. And technically speaking, what happens is that if you consider inputs which are uncorrelated across neurons, but are correlated in time, what you can do is that if you have a stationary process, the covariance matrix would be toplets, or if you want, you can consider periodic boundary condition and it would be actually circulant. So in the end, what you have to consider is just the power spectrum in Fourier space. And the actual error, the regression error, if you want, is epsilon, which is the density of the regression error, will just be an integral over a lambda. And you can think of lambda as like the square root singular values in this case, or the eigenvalue of the covariance matrix, or in other words, it's just the Fourier spectrum. So if you have a certain Fourier spectrum in frequency, it will act on the structure of the weights and will act on the structure on the actual regression error that we will get. In the second case, let's say we measure and we do PCA, and we have a certain spectrum for the singular values, okay? And we don't care about the direction U and V. So we integrate over this whole R measure, because we know that the matrix of the left and right singular vectors are basically orthogonal matrices. So we can integrate over this orthogonal group. We have this complicated integral. And in the end, what we get is the result which describes this delta cube, which basically describes the variance of the distribution of the weights, and epsilon, which describes the actual regression error, will depend on, in general, on the Stieltjes transform of the distribution of the eigenvalue. So we in the end, everything will just depend on the distribution of the eigenvalue distribution of the covariance matrix, which we sort of fix or we measure it, and then we can use this mean field equation if we have a measurement of when n is not actually going to infinity, n is very big, say, even if you have n equal to 100, this kind of equation work very well. And I think that methodologically speaking, it's very interesting to see that if you have IID output, you can actually write this in terms of a quantity which comes again and again in random matrix theory, and it's been sort of studied from different perspective in average stuff equations, in the context of spin glasses, in the context of random matrix theory, which basically is the integrated R transform, which is dualistically connected to what people in information theory call the Shannon transform. So you basically have these quantities which only depend on the spectrum of the covariance matrix in the end, or what on PCA, which people in neuroscience do every day. Okay, so much for the method. What are the results that we have? So the important thing is that the optimal solution for this regression problem are balanced weights. So the notion of balance network comes to mind. So a balanced network is one in which each neuron receives a very strong excitatory current, very strong inhibitory currents, but the two sort of balance, and it's different in the case of sparse and dense network, but the basic idea is that they balance at the level of the mean, so that you have a current which is over the one, but with fluctuation, which are still over the one, so you have Poissonian spiking, for instance, in the case of spiking in or spiking network. And what we see is that at the level of a single neuron, you get basically the same scaling. So if you have an external optimal bias, which is of order square root of n, then so the average weight, this WE, for instance, and the average inhibitory weight, they will be of order one with square root of n, such that when they get multiplied by the average activity, say the average input, the average excitatory input, and the average inhibitory input, they cancel each other. So the mean contribution from the mean gets canceled up to order one with square root of n, and it gives you the what you want in the output, so the average output. And this only works if you optimize over the bias too. So if you don't learn a bias, for instance, you get into the trouble of having a total current which is a function of n is always stays of order one, but this contribution which I'm calling h tilde, which goes up and seems to increase as order square root of n, but is sort of balanced by something else. It's balanced by by correlations between the rates and the variation of the weights with respect to their averages. So you don't get basically a balanced network, which have some very interesting dynamical properties. So you can sort of, in this very simplistic model, you can already see that the optimization of the external current either gives you a solution which is balanced or not in terms of the of optimizing over this quantity I. I think the second interesting result is that there is a sort of a gauge symmetry once you take out this contribution from H tilde. So once you learn the optimal current, there is a gauge symmetry which implies that basically no matter what is the ratio of excitatory inhibitory neurons, and for whatever correlation in the input and output, the optimal capacity for this perceptron is always 0.5. And here, for instance, it says gamma equal to zero. Gamma was the regularization parameter. So at no regularization parameter, you basically can learn an half pattern, and then you start increasing, like the regression error starts increasing linearly. And these curves are for increasing value of the regularization. And you have sort of a smooth transition. And this gauge symmetry also happens to impact the distribution of the weights. So if you look at the optimal distribution of the weights, once you optimize over the external bias, you see this very strong delta function in zero. And again, whatever is the ratio between excitatory and inhibitory neurons, you always have that n half of the synaptic weights are zero. So you have n half of the excitatory and half of the inhibitory are zero. And the shape of the distribution tends to be a Gaussian with variances that you can control. So I'm running out of time. I'll skip this and maybe we can talk afterwards. Just to conclude, I show you that target-based approaches are effective for training recurrent networks, and we can try and understand the structure of the resulting connections inside these recurrent neural networks just by using like very simple models, very simple methods that come from the analysis of feed-forward networks. And that's it.
Thank you very much.